Okay, we go live. I welcome you all, everybody. I welcome you all to this Awake 2020 OSA Conclave, where there will be a launch of mobile app as well, and we have lineup of international speakers as well as national speakers. I've been given a tall task of introducing my my group, which is there, that is Innovative Pedagogical Learning, which is actually the platform on which we have been using for doing various lectures. We have already had around 12 to 13 lectures, and this is the epitome of them, that is the conclave which we are organizing, and it is about a passion which we generated a few months back because of support from higher authorities as well as Government of India, as well as Dr. Priyanka has been instrumental in that. Talking about ourselves, our group, Albert Einstein once said, "A mind that opens to a new idea never returns to its original size." Pandemic times has forced everyone to restrict their physical movement, but mind plays a game of its own. It doesn't know how to restrict, when to pose inhibitions, or it struggles to expand. So this has brought we four people, that is, myself, that is Professor Raman Chaudhary, Jamia Millia Islamia, Dr. Priyanka, Professor Jamia in Jamia Millia Islamia Orthodontic Department. We have Dr. Deepika, again from Jamia Millia Islamia, and we have Pooja, who's there, who worked together, and we started a platform to challenge traditional teaching and learning concepts, focus on innovation, and hold intense discussion on varied academic arenas, skill enhancement, ethics, but maintaining the ethics and basics. Before anyone knew, this IPL has grown into leaps and bounds, and we have more than 700 subscribers on YouTube. We have, as I said, 13 lectures already organized, from varying from it can vary from learning how to make videos to how to improve your teaching standards, how to become a better teacher or a better student. That's what was the aim. And without wasting further time, I would introduce you to two very important people who have joined. We have teachers of teacher, Professor O.P. Kharbanda, who's the chief advisor for the event. He is Dr. C.G. Pandit, national chair of ICMR, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. And another most important person who has joined with us is chief patron for the day, Professor Sanjay Singh, Dean, Faculty of Dentistry, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. Before he became professor and dean, he is a friend and a guardian to me. I welcome you both, sir. Sir, Dr. Kharbanda will be chairing, as well as he's the moderator. He'll be summing up as well. I pass the mic to Professor Sanjay Singh to give a welcome address to this August gathering. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Aman. Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I take this opportunity to extend my heartiest wishes to Team IPL for conceptualizing and bringing the idea of interdisciplinary OSA conclave to life. Obstructive sleep apnea, as we all know, is a global menace with a high prevalence both in adults and pediatric population. With its severe complications involving cardiovascular, neurocognitive, and behavioral domains, it becomes an interdisciplinary forte for diagnosis and management. There are established roles of otolaryngologists, sleep specialists, surgeons, pediatric ENTs, oral and maxillofacial surgeons, orthodontists, oral medicine, to name a few. However, there is a lacune of interdisciplinary discussions like this conclave to sit together on a common platform and to discuss each aspect with holistic approach. And for this, I feel immensely happy to welcome our national and international speakers of the day. To highlight the multiple modality of OSA treatment in Indian context, I welcome Professor Dr. J.C. Suri, who started this first sleep lab in India. to highlight effect of orthodontic treatment and airway, I welcome Dr. William Harrell from University of Alabama, USA. For pediatric ENT management, we are fortunate to have with us an accomplished ENT surgeon from Queensland, Australia, Dr. David McIntosh. And for discussing the oral surgical procedures in sleep disorder management, we have Dr. Rishi J. Gupta, Chief Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery and Sleep Surgeon, University of California. I would like to welcome our chief advisor and moderator for the event, Professor Dr. O.P. Kharbanda, an accomplished academician, a teacher par excellence, currently holding the prestigious G.C. Pant National Chair of ICMR. Last but not the least, I welcome all the delegates who have registered for this event very enthusiastically. Without taking much time, I hand over the session to our chief moderator, Dr. O.P. Kharbanda, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay, and team IPL, and esteemed speakers of the day. Good morning to you, and good morning to all the participants who are attending the session. Without taking much time, the only thing I wish to emphasize here is that as dentists, we should be aware of obstructive sleep apnea, both in young children and adults, and we sometimes miss that opportunity to guide them. Particularly young children, as an orthodontist, I have not only recognized over the years, but also was able to help them by modulating the growth of the lower jaw, expanding the oral cavities, making through the nose, and so many other procedures, which I think our ENT specialist is going to talk about it. In adult patients, while performing dental procedures, there was a situation when we could know that this particular patient sitting on the chair could be a potential OSA patient. So as a dentist, our duty is not only to look after teeth or the gums or the oral cavity, but an holistic approach to the patient. The person who visits to us is an individual, and we have to treat him as individual, not his teeth, but his biology, his physiology, his health. And if we as a dentist get involved in his care, I think society is going to respect us much more. And if we do not, I think we are failing our duty as healthcare worker. So let us broaden our vision, broaden our horizons, think beyond teeth, and help others. So I know so many people are waiting to hear the learned speakers. Without taking much time, I will request Dr. Suri to please initiate. But before, to just give him his little bit of introduction, I have known Dr. Suri for many, many years while he was working in the Safdarjung Hospital and in sleep medicine. But now he has moved to, he's now director of, head of medicine at Salvation. Dr. Suri is also founder of Indian Sleep Association, actually, and his contribution to sleep medicine is immense. And let us now hear from him his words of wisdom and how he would think we as dentists can also play a role in helping the patients. Thank you, sir. The screen is yours, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Kharbanda, for the nice introduction. Thank you, Dr. Priyanka, Dr. Aman, for this for this invitation for such an important conclave. I am really overwhelmed, and thank you for inviting me to speak on a subject which is very important in the current times. So what I am going to do today is to discuss with you multimodality treatment approach to a case of obstructive sleep apnea. Now, we all know that that obstructive sleep apnea is a disorder which is characterized by partial or complete collapse of the upper airway, resulting into apneas, hypopneas, or even hypoventilation due to the repetitive collapse. If this disease remains untreated, it is associated with symptoms of excessive daytime sleepiness, which can lead to accidents, impaired daytime function, leading to poor quality of life. It can lead to metabolic dysfunction, increased risk of cardiovascular disease, and mortality. Adverse consequences of OSA can also pose an enormous health and economic burden. So if you can see here on this cartoon, you can look into the complications. So on your right side, you have the cardiovascular complications. They are in the form of endothelial dysfunction, hypertension, coronary artery disease, stroke, atrial fibrillation. And then it has an impact on the mind in the terms of cognitive dysfunction, behavioral dysfunction, excessive daytime sleepiness, and then the metabolic consequences in the form of insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, and diabetes. Recently, it has also been seen that OSA may also be associated with cancer. So you can see that this is a disease with diverse consequences. It practically involves each and every organ of the body. So it's a very, very important disease and needs to be not only diagnosed early, but also treated effectively. So if you want to. So what are the treatment objectives? The treatment objectives are to reduce sleepiness, to improve quality of life, decrease long-term cardiovascular consequences, which I have just discussed, and overall reduce morbidity and mortality. When we should treat? So we should treat a patient with obstructive sleep apnea when his disease is severe enough to cause immediate symptoms as well as long-term complications. And to find a cutoff line of the abdominal respiratory events in sleep, we have used various longitudinal studies, observational studies, like sleep heart health studies. So various studies which have followed up the cohorts over a long period of time, and you have looked into the consequences. And what we have come to an arbitrary figure, there's that anybody who is symptomatic, like EDS, loud snoring, and has the apnea hypopnea index, or what we call respiratory distress index, which also includes respiratory effort related arousals, if it is more than 5 and with symptoms, or anybody who is having a respiratory disturbance index of more than 15 should be treated. Now, what are the basic principles of management? The effective treatment of a patient with obstructive sleep apnea requires a patient-centered chronic disease management approach, which should ensure adequate resolution of disease that goes beyond the initial diagnosis and therapy prescription. And once you achieve that, it is very important to monitor these patients, to look for the adherence to the treatment and take all the measures to enhance their adherence. And then if you find that their adherence is not optimum, then providing alternative therapeutic modalities when the primary treatment fails or not tolerated. And along with this, we also should manage comorbid sleep disorders, comorbid conditions like diabetes, hypertension. Those also needs to be optimized to improve long-term health-related outcomes. We all know that CPAP is definitely the first treatment of choice for all freshly diagnosed cases of moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea. So I have not included mild in this, because in the mild, you can use alternative therapies, second-line therapies, the orodontal devices, can be maybe the first line treatment in many cases of mild disease. But for moderate to severe disease, I think CPAP remains the first line of treatment. And what are the reasons for using CPAP as the initial treatment? We know that CPAP is the most efficacious treatment. What we mean by efficacious treatment, that means in sleep laboratory, when you are evaluating a patient of sleep apnea, you see all those apneas and hypopneas. And when you put CPAP on them in the lab itself and titrate the pressure, you are able to see that all the abnormal breathing events have been completely eliminated. So that is what we mean by efficacy. So we can prove, you know, in the sleep laboratory while doing polysomnography that there is a complete resolution of all abnormal obstructive breathing events and which can be confirmed in a sleep study. So that's the main reason that it is most efficacious. We can see that, you know, which we can't see, you know, when we are using dental devices. Of course, now we have dental devices, titrating dental devices, so we can even see with that also. But with surgery, we have to see that after the surgery has been performed. Secondly, CPAP has been most extensively studied modality because we have a huge body of scientific evidence in the form of randomized controlled trials, systematic reviews, meta-analysis, supporting its efficacy and favorable long-term outcomes. You know, you can see the number of, you know, this is a meta-analysis which was published last year and by American Academy of Sleep Medicine. And you see the number of RCTs which have been done for sleepy patient, and you see that it significantly improves the subjective sensation of sleepiness. Even in non-sleepy patients also, when you do this, you can see that it is CPAP is associated with significant improvement or reduction in the what you call Epworth sleepiness scale, you know. And then there are number of you know, systematic reviews studying the effect of CPAP on quality of life, on motor vehicle accidents, on neurophysiological functions, on cardiovascular consequences, blood pressure. So all these things, we have a lot of body of evidence to prove that CPAP is the most effective treatment. Then the third thing is that CPAP can also be used as a therapeutic trial. What we mean by therapeutic trial, are we not sure that our patient is having sleep apnea? Because you know that symptoms of sleep apneas are very non-specific. So most of the clinical symptoms like sleepiness can be seen in other conditions like depression, narcolepsy, so fatigue, tiredness. So that can also be seen in patients with cardiac failure. So the symptoms are non-specific and common with other things. So if you have a patient with sleepiness who may have a mild disease, but he has a severe sleepiness, then, you know, whether the sleepiness or tiredness or fatigue is due to obstructive sleep apnea or due to the other condition, you can give a therapeutic trial with CPAP. And then if there is a complete resolution of symptoms, then you can say in retrospect that the patient's symptoms were due to obstructive sleep apnea. So when you treat a patient with the multiple comorbidities, that means a patient may have obstructive sleep apnea plus depression, which is commonly associated with sleepiness, or with narcolepsy. So when you treat this patient with CPAP, there will be a partial resolution of disease, and then you may have to add treatment for these conditions to have complete resolution of these patients. And then CPAP can also be very useful in identifying other phenotypes of OSA. Now, what do we mean by other phenotypes of OSA? Now we know that obstructive sleep apnea is not one disease. It is a group of heterogeneous disorders. It is a syndrome. So conventionally, you know, we have been thinking that most of the OSA patients have anatomically small pharynx, which is kept open during waking hours by the overactivity of the pharyngeal dilator muscle, which is lost significantly during sleep, leading to partial or complete collapse of the upper airway. So this understanding gives that CPAP, that OSA is an anatomical disease, and if we correct the anatomy of this, then the disease can be cured. But now we know that there are other pathophysiological mechanisms which are complex and may be involved in the pathophysiology of obstructive sleep apnea. So the important factors, one, of course, the anatomical factor, which I just talked to you, which means that it's a small pharynx. Small pharynx can be due to obesity, due to craniofacial abnormalities, retrognathia, and the micrognathia. So all these things are the presence of a large tonsils, adenoids. So these factors will be there. But then there are other factors like inadequate pharyngeal dilator muscle response, you know, because normally to overcome the deficient anatomy, the pharyngeal dilator muscle have to overact. You know, their activity is increased to keep the passage open. Then low arousal threshold. Now, how is this low arousal threshold important? Because when a person develops sleep apnea, when the upper airway closes, the resistance increases, the local receptors are activated. You know, the negative pressure receptors are activated, and there is an increase in the effort to breathe. So once there is an increase in effort to breathe, this is sensed by the brain and it creates an arousal. So those people who have a very low threshold will immediately wake up and terminate this this pathophysiology of sleep apnea. And those with a high arousal threshold can go on to develop frank apneas. And so this is another very important factor. And then is the high loop gain. High loop gain is a phenomena that for a given change in the carbon dioxide, when there is hypoventilation or due to any event, if the carbon dioxide increases, the response is an increased ventilation. And some people actually respond excessively, resulting into overventilation and decrease in the carbon dioxide level. And once this carbon dioxide level decreases below the apneic threshold, these patients stop breathing. When they stop breathing, there is a hypotonia of the muscles of the pharynx, and this results into collapse of their pharynx. So it's a very complex problem. You know, the sleep apnea is an anatomical, then there are other factors which are contributing. And if these other factors are contributing, then CPAP alone may not be effective in this treatment. Even surgery and other measures may not be effective because the other factor needs additional treatment. And this additional treatment may be in the form of oxygen, in the form of Dymox, or adding a dead space, particularly in patients with high loop gain, or we may have to use sedatives in patients to increase their arousal threshold. And those patients with a very low muscle responsiveness, the hypoglossal nerve stimulation procedures can be done, you know. The important factor with CPAP is the initial acceptance and the adherence. And you can see that from this, that when you prescribe CPAP, only 50% of the patients are able to use for more than 6 hours. And the remaining 50% only uses 3.4 to 1.0. So this is far less than what we are we expect, from a patient to get long-term benefit in this treatment. The other thing is that those patients who do not comply with CPAP will actually do so in the first week of treatment. And you can see the lower graph is a patient who developed poor compliance with CPAP, and it happens in the fourth or fifth day. So it's very, very important to monitor this patient very closely and see that the look into the patients who are not complying with the treatment, and we have to give enough measures. So the importance of the first week is in the adherence in the initial few days, predict long-term adherence, because those who are not likely to adhere will show in the first week, and that gives the importance of monitoring, and particularly patients who are living far away, the use of telemonitoring to see that whether they are complying with their treatment or not. And then you have to identify early and troubleshoot the reasons for poor compliance. And for this, you need trained personnel and CPAP educators. The another very important thing is that the outcome of treatment with CPAP would depend upon the number of hours the patient uses this device in sleep. And you can see here that as the number of nightly CPAP use increases in terms of hours, you can see the outcome in terms of maybe be it sleepiness, be it blood pressure, be it cognitive function, also improve. So it's very, very important that adherence has to be very good. So why CPAP adherence is important? Because it is a very common disease. If you see in the systematic review, which was published in 2017, the prevalence of a moderate to severe disease is between 6 to 17%, which is a huge number. And it is a serious medical condition associated with motor vehicle crashes, systemic hypertension, diabetes, coronary artery disease, stroke, atrial fibrillation, congestive heart failure, and increased mortality. CPAP is an effective treatment. We know that it is a very effective, efficacious, I won't say effective, efficacious treatment. It is able to eliminate all the abnormal events provided it is used adequately by this patient. But the CPAP adherence is a big challenge. And we know at present that with our best effort, we have not been able to achieve adherence to this treatment in more than 50% of cases. That means we need alternative therapies for this 50% of patients who either fail to adhere, those who either don't accept this treatment or they fail to adhere adequately for adequate time to have long-term benefits for this treatment. And the various barriers which we have found to CPAP use are psychological factors, the common side effects associated with mask interface, and of course the cost of the treatment. And now we have various measures people have used, various educational, psychological, and behavioral interventions, which have significantly improved the adherence of this patient, which involves patient education about the disease, about the long-term consequences, and what are the treatment options. So you need to educate your patient with different about the disease, about the complication, and the different options of treatment. Then you have to regularly do motivational enhancement therapies, CBTI, the cognitive behavior therapies, and then other support measures and use of telemonitoring. To improve the adherence, CPAP technology has also improved. We have now a lot of new devices which has come. We have developed flexible pressure, C-Flex, A-Flex. There are other machines like auto CPAPs, bi-levels. Different types of mask interfaces have been developed to improve this thing, and the use of heated humidification. All these measures have been done to improve adherence, but this, in general, if you use all this in unselected patient, it does not lead to much benefit. But definitely in selected patient, it has a role. So what are the other therapeutic alternatives for who decline or not respond adequately to CPAP therapy? And for that, we have certain conservative measures like weight reduction, use of drugs.
It's 9:30.
Okay. So we have this position. Then we have positional therapies, oral appliances, and upper airway surgeries, which are two types. One is the nasal surgeries, which are used to improve the CPAP, and the palatal surgeries, which make it more difficult for the patient to tolerate this thing. So there are two types of oral appliances, the appliances which pull the tongue forward and those which pull the mandible forward. And this is the one which is used to move the tongue forward, and this is the one which moves the mandible forward. And these are actually very useful in patients who are younger in age, females, and those with less severe obstructive sleep apnea. As I told you, the mild sleep apnea are probably the oral appliances may be better than CPAP in many of these cases. Supine dependent OSA with lower body mass index and patient with the lower neck circumference. Some lateral cephalometric features which are predictor for success of oral device, like retrographic mandible, lower height position, and of course these are the greater angle between cranial base and mandibular plane. I think these will be discussed later on. So we have seen that mandibular advancement devices improve somnolence, they improve vigilance and neurocognitive function, neurocognitive performance. Recently we have seen that they also improve blood pressure. So you can see the improvement in the AHI score, which is equivalent to CPAP. On the right side is the orodental device, and the left side is the CPAP, and the compliance is, and it is quite good for mild to moderate cases. So this is not a very good device for severe disease. And also, we have seen that obstructive sleep, the orodontal advices, appliances have been associated with the reduction in the blood pressure, which is equivalent to the CPAP for this thing. And the compliance is also equivalent to CPAP. So oral appliances, though not as effective as CPAP, particularly for the severe disease, it improves OSA in majority of the patient, generally well tolerated, and they have less discontinuation side effects, preferred to CPAP by majority of patients, and it is associated with improvement in sleepiness, quality of life, driving performance, and blood pressure. So these are the variety of orodontal devices available to us. And then I will talk about surgery. We have two types of surgeries available. One, what we call adjunctive surgery. This is basically a nasal surgery, which is used to improve the compliance of CPAP, because we want to treat the nasal obstruction, the adenoids, the deviated nasal septum, hypertrophy of the turbinates. So these things. And the second is the salvage surgery, where you want to do a surgery on your palate and on the tongue base to improve sleep apnea. So these are the various surgical options which are available. I think they will be discussed in detail. But what I want to just mention from my, as a physician's perspective, the uvular palatopharyngoplasty, which is the most commonly performed surgery, is effective only in 50% of the cases. And it is basically the selection of the patient. If you select your patient well, you know, then it can be successful in selected. You can see, you know, in stage one, where you know, it's involvement of basically the if the patient has tonsil, adenoids, and the tongue base involvement is not there, this type of surgery may be useful. But in majority of cases, there is a combination of palate as well as the tongue base involvement. So that is why these surgeries may not be very good. What about the tongue-based treatment? So there are multiple tongue-based surgeries available, like radio frequency ablation, genioglossal advancement, tongue-based suspension. But overall, if you do these tongue-based surgeries, the results are anything between 30 to 50%, at best about 67% of there. So when you combine palate and hypopharyngeal surgery, so you treat pharynx and you treat palate as well as the tongue-based. And then if you combine this, still, if you see that the success is varying between 20 to 78%. So why we are not getting good result for this combined surgery? Basically, it is because of our evaluation. Most of the evaluations which are done are done during awake stage. So we are not able to localize the sites of obstruction when we are doing procedures like Friedman staging, nasopharyngoscopy, kephalometry. So this has been the reason that our evaluation has not been very good. So we have not been able to plan the surgeries on the basis of this. Now we have the procedures like drug-induced sleep endoscopy or dynamic CT or MRI. With the help of these procedures, you will be able to, you know, more accurately, you will be able to localize the obstruction. And I'm sure with the use of drug-induced endoscopy, which is the next topic, the outcome of this patient is likely to improve. The another very important thing which we can do in very obese patient is the loss of weight, which can be with medical management, conservative means, or by bariatric surgery. And what you can do is that you can convert these patients from non-positional to positional sleep apnea. So when you treat, do the weight reduction, after that, if you give positional therapy, large number of these patients can respond to this therapy. So what I'm trying to say is that the successful treatment criteria for surgery, what is the successful criteria? For most of them, the successful criteria is that either there is a 50% reduction in AHI or the overall AHI should become less than 20. But when we are thinking about the CPAP, we say that it should come down below 5. So there are different criteria for success when you are using CPAP and when you are using surgery. So the current status of the available treatment is that we should achieve a goal of a mean of AHI of less than 5 for surgery, for CPAP, and for oral appliance, which is rarely achievable. So we cannot achieve this because of the compliance problem with CPAP and surgery not being that effective. Now, of course, with better selection of the cases, it may and the use of CPAP. So there is a need to develop multimodality approach to achieve optimal goals in these patients. And you know that the CPAP, when you use CPAP, you achieve less than 5. But if you don't use CPAP adequately whole night, then of course the, you will not be able to achieve the same results for this thing. And after surgery, again, although there is no compliance issue, but then it may not be 100%. It does not have 100% efficacy. So after surgery, the AHI remains relatively consistent during night, but with CPAP, it may dip below 5 during certain percentage of total sleep time and increase during the rest of the night when CPAP is not being used. Success of surgery is poor, but if it works, the effect is continuous. The effect of CPAP is 100% if the patient is compliant, but the compliance rate is poor. So to achieve this, we have to have a multi-modality approach where you can use CPAP plus surgery, adjunctive nasal surgery, CPAP plus surgery, palatal or tongue surgery. You know, this nasal surgery is basically to improve the compliance of the CPAP, CPAP plus orodental device, surgery plus orodental device, and then bariatric surgery plus this thing. So this is a device where you are using a CPAP mask with orodental device. So this is a combination of PAP and orodental appliance, you know, and these are the various possible treatments available to us. And it is very important that we look into this. So it's very, very important for us to have a clinic where we should provide a comprehensive treatment to patient with obstructive sleep apnea, where, you know, you have a sleep physician, you have the facility to provide CPAP. These patients should also be evaluated by a dentist and a surgeon. So like we have for cancers, you have a tumor board where you have a radiotherapist, you have a surgeon, cancer surgeon, and you have a medical oncologist. Similarly, I think there is a need to have a comprehensive sleep center where you can provide, where you can evaluate these patients from the angle of CPAP, from the angle of orodental device, from the surgical point of view, and then you can provide these patients different treatment options, and also you can let the patient himself decide his own choice for a particular treatment. And I think once we have those kinds of comprehensive clinic, then only we will be able to provide a good and effective treatment which will provide long-term benefit to these patients. Thank you for your kind attention.
Could you
I'll stop here.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Suri. I think you have given a wonderful overview of the OSA and sleep-related disorders, including how effective the dental appliances could be. We have experience with iterable appliances. That is what we use very often in AIMS, and also the mandibular repositioner. Now, I have a question for you, which I think I need to ask you now, because this is a question which is related to both sleep and internal medicine. And this question, I hope you are willing to respond. Now, the question it reads, this question is by Dr. Gattapalli Gauri Shankar Krishna. What are the roles of estimation of insulin and glucose levels from cerebrospinal fluid in the diagnosis of central sleep apnea and type 3 diabetes mellitus? And what is the role of metformin, chromium and vitamin C in the treatment of central sleep apnea? So he has one more question, but I thought let us discuss this first here. Maybe briefly you can answer it here.
It's a very, very interesting question. I think the first time I'm facing a question like this. I just want to say that central sleep apnea is a very heterogeneous group of conditions. It is not one condition, you know. And central sleep apneas may be associated with hypoventilation, hyperventilation. It's a part of loop gain. It can be part of congestive heart failure. It can be seen in patient with morphine and addiction. So central sleep apnea is not one condition, and its consequences also have been studied only with reference to cardiovascular diseases. The metabolic consequences which has been asked in these questions are more related to obstructive sleep apnea. And we know that in obstructive sleep apnea, these patients do develop insulin resistance, and they have when you treat this patient with CPAP, there is a significant reduction in the insulin resistance. So specifically with reference to measurement of insulin levels in this cerebrospinal fluid, I am not aware of any study. I think if this question has been asked, there must be some basis, but I am not aware of any such thing, particularly with reference to central sleep apnea.
Thank you for this response. I think Dr. Gauri can maybe also interact with you in person, and you can guide him where to find him, sir, because this question is absolutely related to the internal medicine.
Yeah.
And I will not be able to comment on this at all. Thank you, sir, for giving us an overview. And I think the most important thing you said, that there is a need to coordinate and establish a sleep center, which is very, very important. And with regard to the Indian Council of Medical Research had set up a group to make the guidelines. We had to create the evidence-based guidelines, and I was looking after the oral appliances and the craniofacial surgery. And I think the oral appliances do have a role, provided the case selection is right. So the case selection is, I think, critical for the success of the oral appliance. So they don't work everywhere, but you should know. And also, I think the sleep appliances can be used as an therapeutic diagnosis of OSA before you put him on CPAP. So that was the other indication which we like to say. So if there are any questions with respect to Dr. Suri, I think I will invite Dr. Harrell to give his lecture. And I like to thank Dr. Suri for his significant contribution to this claim. And I think our interactions will continue.